وأقول في القرآن ما جاءت به آياته فهو الكريم المنزال وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد وإن شرح هذا الكتاب النزهة النظر في توضيح نخبة الفقر written by الإمام حافظ ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى. We've previously spoken about the following. Hafiz ibn Hajar, at the beginning, what he did was he categorized the khabar that has reached us, the khabar bi'tibari wusulihi ilayna, the khabar in terms of how it reached us. He categorized it into how much mutawatir and what ahad. A hadith that has reached multitude narration. And the mutawatir, we categorized it into two. Mutawatir lafzi and mutawatir ma'nawi. Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala, he categorized the khabar in terms of how it reached us into two. Mutawatir, which is multitude narration. And ahad, which is that which has not reached multitude narration. The mutawatir, we said, is two, lafzi and ma'nawi. And the ahad, we categorized it into two. We categorized it into two. The first categorization is bi'tibari adadi turuqihi, in terms of the amount of narrators there are in it. And that one we categorized it into three: mashhur, aziz, and then gharib. And then we went to the second type of ahad. We said bi'tibari quwwatihi wa da'fihi, in terms of its strength and in terms of its weakness. Because remember, we said the khabar which is mutawatir, a hadith which is mutawatir, we don't look at it whether it's strong or weak. The mutawatir doesn't go into that discussion. Only the hadith that's observed, that is looked at, whether it's strong or weak, is the hadith which are ahad. So bi'tibari quwwatihi wa da'fi is where we were in. We previously spoke about the maqbool, the accepted ahadith. That was the first time. And of course, there's the mardood. We haven't touched on the mardood yet. We are in the maqbool. And the maqbool, we said, is of two types. The hadith, which is ahad, that is looked at from the first time, which is maqbool, is of two types. The first one is bi'tibari martabatihi, in terms of its level. Or in terms of its level, now. In terms of its levels. And that we said is sahih and what? Hasan. Sahih al-Hasan. And the Sahih we categorize into two: Sahih al-Lidati, Sahih al-Lighayri. And the Hasan we categorize into two: Hasan al-Lidati and Hasan al-Lighayri. Today we're going to go into the second type of hadith, which is maqbool. The second type is what we're going to go in today. And it's the second type of categorization of the hadith, which is maqbool. If you look at the Nuzhatul Nadar, Hafiz ibn Hajar says, Rahimahullah ta'ala, you look at the Nuzhatul Nadar and the Tawdih, Nukhbatul Fikr. So let's look at the Nukhbatul, let's look at the Nuzhatul Nadar. Hafiz ibn Hajar says, ثم المقبول ينقسم أيضا إلى معمول به وغير معمول به. That's the second type of categorization of maqbool. In terms of whether it's implemented or whether it's not implemented. Here he goes into معمول به and غير معمول به. The معمول به is two. It's the muhkam and the nasikh. Just remember that. The muhkam and the nasikh are the only two that are implemented. Okay? This hadith is maqbool and it's implemented. And then we're going to see the ghayru ma'mool, that which is not implemented. And it's two types, inshaAllah ta'ala. It is the mukhtalaful hadith and it's the what? And it's the mansukh, the abrogated one. Here is, inshaAllah, we're going to understand what it means al-muhkam. What it means al-muhkam. He says, ثُمَّ الْمَقْبُولُ إِنْ سَلِمَ مِنَ الْمُعَارَضَةِ فَهُوَ الْمُحْكَمُ. This is what muhkam means. Muhkam means a hadith that is free from any opposition. In salima min al-mu'aradati. If a hadith is safe from any opposition, it's called muhkam. Do we implement it? Of course we do. The reason why we implement it is because it's safe from what? Any type of opposition. There's no other hadith that is opposing it. Hafiz al-Hajr said, look what he said in his nusha. He says, لَمْ يَأْتِ خَبَرٌ يُضَادُهُ. No other narration has come to oppose it. فَهُوَ الْمُحْكَمُ وَأَمْثِلَتُهُ كَثِيرَةٌ. And examples for that are a lot. Any hadith that we know of that has no opposition, and there are many, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَاتِ is from them, many ahadiths that there is no opposition for it. This is called what? It's called a muhkam. وَإِنْ عُرِضَ. What about if this hadith has an opposition? There's a hadith that seems to be opposing it. There's a hadith that's opposing it. But this hadith that's opposing it is بِمِثْلِهِ like it. It's a hadith that's like it. Hafidh then says, وَإِنْ عُرِضَ بِمِثْلِهِ. If it's been opposed, this hadith is being opposed with another hadith. Okay? بِمِثْلِهِ. فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ. If you're able to bring them together, there's a hadith opposing another hadith. فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ. If there's a possibility to bring them together. فَمُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. This hadith calls مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. The مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ is a what? It's a hadith which is عُرِضَ بِمِثْلِهِ. There's an opposition like it. فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ الْجَمْعُ. If there's a possibility to bring them together. فَمُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. This hadith is called a مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. Ibn Salah rahimahullah, in his Muqaddimah, page 143, he mentions an example for this. The example for a hadith which is مختلف الحديث is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he says, لَا عَدْوَ وَلَا طِيَّرَةَ وَلَا هَامَّةَ وَلَا صَفَرَ وَلَا غُول. The first part is what concerns us here. لَا عَدْوَ. عَدْوَ means what? عَدْوَ here means there is no transmittable disease. La adwa. There's no illness that a person has that he can pass it over to somebody else. That's what one hadith says. One hadith negates any illness that a person can give to another person. Okay? We have another hadith that says, firra, run away from. Min al majdumi, the one who has leprosy. Firaraka min al asadi, the way you run away from a lion. So why would a person run away from a person who has leprosy? Because his illness is gonna happen to you. But the other hadith says what? That there's no illness that. So this hadith is مختلف الحديث. But is there a way to reconcile between the two? Ha, there is a way to reconcile between the two. Which is what? Ibn Hajar tells you, وَجْهُ الْجَمْعِ بَيْنَهُمَا. The way to bring them together is, أَنَّ هَذِي الْأَمْرَاضِ لَا تُعَدَّ بِطَبْعِهَا. Illness does not transmit in and within itself. So when the Prophet negated la adwa, there's no illness that transmits, he means that the illness itself can't move. It moves with whose permission? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what that means. And the other hadith, it tells us to take the means to prevent yourself from it. Sah? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he could take away from the fire burning, and the fire may not burn a person. Okay, that doesn't mean if you throw yourself in a fire and say, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, if he wills, he will not burn me. Okay? You take the precautions and you take the means. So this two hadiths, there is no opposition towards one another. The one that's negating is negating the illness in itself cannot go from one person to another. It needs whose permission? Allah's permission. The other hadith is talking about taking the means and to be careful. So this hadith is called what? It's a hadith which is mukhtalaful hadith. It's a hadith which is mukhtalaful hadith. Al-Imam al-Tahawi rahimahullah, what he did was, he took these type of hadith. He took these ahadith and he made a book in authorship of it. He authored a book in these types of ahadith. And he worked on them. Rahimahullah. رحمة واسعة الإمام الطحاوي رحمه الله يوثد كتاب شرح معاني الآثار أما his كتاب مشكل الآثار sorry رحمه الله رحمة واسعة. And many other scholars, they also speak about it. Ibn Hajar is Fathul Bari, many places he speaks about these ahadith which are مختلف الحديث. You find him talk about it. Nawawi does it as well. Ibn al-Arabi, the Maliki scholar, in his A'radatul Ahwadi, which is Sanah al-Sunan al-Tirmidhi, he speaks about it. Ibn al-Qayyim in his Tahdib al-Sunan, he also deals with it as well. And other scholars do so as well. Awla, what about if the two ahadith can't be brought together? Okay, we spoke about one type of ma'mulun bih. What's the ma'mulun bih? The hadith that's implemented is the muhkam. We've learned it, right? Okay, the hadith which is غَيْرُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ is what? The مُخْتَلَف. صح؟ غَيْرُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ is the مُخْتَلَف. Now we're going to go into another, what's the second type of مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ? نَاسِق. And the second type of غَيْرُ مَعْمُولٌ بِهِ is what? مَنْصُوخ. So we're going to do those two. أَوْلَى. If you're not able to, awla here, Ibn Hajar means rahimahullah ta'ala, what does he mean? Awla, that we're not able to bring them together. It is not possible to bring the two together. There's no way to reconcile the two. There's no way to bring them together. وَثَبَتَ الْمُتَأَخِيرُ. And the late one is established now. We know which one of the two ahadiths was late. وَثَبَتَ الْمُتَأَخِرُ. The late one is known. We know which of the two hadiths came late. We know that. وَثَبَتَ الْمُتَأَخِرُ فَهُوَ النَّاسِخُ. Then the late one is the abrogator. It abrogates. وَالْآخَرُ الْمَنْسُخُ. And the one that's earlier is the one that's abrogated. What does نَسْخ mean? What does abrogation mean? It means رفع تعلق حكم شرعي بدليل شرعي متأخر عنه. It's the uplifting of a شرعي ruling with another شرعي ruling that came after it. The ناسخ is the one that abrogates. ما يدل على رفع المذكوري. It's the one that comes and it uplifts the ruling. Ibn Hajar then says, وَتَسْمِيَتُهُ نَاسِخًا مَجَازٌ. To call it the abrogator, this hadith, to call it the abrogator, he said this is majaz, is metaphorically. The reason why he said is because لِأَنَّ النَّاسِخ فِي الْحَقِيقَةِ هُوَ اللَّهِ. The one who really abrogates is Allah, not the hadith. Then Ibn Hajar rahimahullah gives you ways to recognize the hadiths that abrogate. How do you identify which hadith will abrogate another hadith? Sometimes it comes by nas, number one. مَا وَرَدَ فِي النَّصِ. Sometimes the ahadith itself mentions the abrogation. As it's in Sahih Muslim. Okay? As it's in what? Sahih Muslim. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, hadith Burayda. The Prophet said, كُنْتُ I was. نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves. فَزُورُوهَا. Go and visit the graves. فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُ الْآخِرَةِ. It will remind you of the hereafter. So the Prophet here, what did he say? كُنْتُ I used to. Before, I used to نهيتكم, I used to prohibit you. عَنْ زِيَارَةِ الْقُبُورِ. I used to prohibit you from visiting the graves. فَزُورُوهَا. Go now and visit the graves. فَإِنَّهَا تُذَكِّرُ الْآخِرَةَ. It will remind you of the hereafter. So this one, already it's clear. The Prophet is saying that my previous ruling was this, and now I'm saying to you different. So in other words, I've abrogated my previous ruling, which is to stop you from going to the graves. I am now telling you, go to the graves. This is what? It is ما ورد الناس في النص. It came in the text, right? The second one is ما يجزم الصحابي بأنه متأخر. A companion would say that this hadith came later than this hadith. The Sahabi would say that. Sahih? A companion would clearly say that this hadith came after this hadith in timing. As it's in the hadith of Jabir, that he said, كَانَ آخِرَ الْأَمْرَيْنِ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. The last of the two affairs of the Prophet, meaning the two things, the last affairs, was of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, تَارُكُ الْوُضُوءِ مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ. Leaving off, doing wudu, what went through fire. Before the Prophet ﷺ, what did he say? تَوَضَّعُ مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ. The Prophet commanded the companions, if you eat any food that goes into the fire, what do? Anything that's cooked, you have to do wudu from it. That's what he said. Jabir here is saying, the last of the affairs, كَانَ آخِرَ الْأَمْرَيْنِ. The last of the affairs in this issue was what? تَارُكُ الْوُضُوءِ مِمَّا مَسَّتِ النَّارِ. And there's only istithna here, there's an only exception here. Okay? Which is hadith, which is what? The eating of the meat of the camel. That's the only istithna. Okay? Some of the scholars thought that this is abrogating all of the, even the camel meat. But that isn't the case. This is abrogating the rest other than the camel meat. Other than the camel meat. So if a person eats any other meat now, goat meat, cow meat, it doesn't matter. What do? They don't do wudu. Why? Because it's abrogated. Why is it abrogated? Based on the statement of Jabir. Jabir told us that this was the last of the affairs. The person doesn't have to do wudu. The person doesn't have to do wudu. They will leave off doing wudu. Very good. Third one is, ما يُعْرَفُ بِالتَّارِيخِ وَهُوَ كَثِيرٌ. And the third way of knowing it is that the person will know the tariq. They will research and they will come to finding the time that this incident took place. Hafiz al-Hajri, in his Mus'haf al-Nadhr, he points out a very important point, which we tend to find in many people, which is, a lot of people say to you, this hadith, abrogated this hadith, how do you know? Abu Hurairah narrated it, and Abu Hurairah took Islam later, and because he took Islam later, his Islam was after the companion, so and so, so that means that this hadith is abrogating the other hadith. وَهَذَا غَيْرُ صَحِيحٌ. That's incorrect. Because why? Abu Hurairah could narrate this hadith from another companion. And it's very common, riwayat al-sahabi, and al-sahabi, al-sahabi narrated from another companion, it happens a lot. So Hafiz ibn Hajar, look what he says in his Nusrat al-Nadr. He says, وَلَيْسَ مِنْهَا مَا يَرْوِيهِ الصَّحَابِيُّ الْمُتَأَخِّرُ الْإِسْلَامِ مُعَارِضًا لِلْمُتَقَدِّمِ عَلِيْهِ لِإِحْتِمَالِ أَنْ يَكُونَ سَمِعَهُ مِنْ صَحَابِيٍ آخَرَ أَقْدَمَ مِنَ الْمُتَقَدِّمِ الْمَذْكُورِ أَوْ مِثْلِهِ فَأَرْسَلَهُ. It could be the Mursal al-Sahabi, that a companion heard from another companion. So it could be that Abu Huraira heard it from Abu Bakr, who was from the early people who came into Islam. And you're straight away saying, based on the fact that Abu Hurairah was last in Islam, then that means he had this hadith late, so then this hadith of Abu Hurairah abrogated the hadith of Jabir or the hadith of Fulan. And that is incorrect. That's not a correct way of knowing that. But if there is in the narration that shows that Abu Hurairah heard this on the battle of so-and-so, مثلاً, and we know that the battle of Uhud took place after مثلاً, the battle of Badr, مثلاً. And Abu Hurairah says this happened on this day of the Uhud, the Prophet said this. And then we have another narration that took place on the Battle of Badr. By history we know what? That Uhud and Badr, between them was one year. Uhud, Badr took place on the 17th of Ramadan on Friday. And we know that Uhud took place, three qawl of the ulama, there's three qawl. Some said it took the 5th, some say no, it's the 11th, and some they said the 15th of Shawwal. The third year of Hijriyah, on Shawwal, the third year of the Hijriyah. Whereas Badr, the second year of Hijriyah, Ramadan 17th. Sahabas were fasting that day. So we have 1 year gap between the two. Historically, we know now what is being narrated in Badr and what is narrated in Uhud. There's a what? There's a year difference. So we'll say, na'am, it abrogated it, based on the fact that we know the history and we know the tariq of this time. Another question arises, can a consent abrogate? Can the consent abrogate? The scholars, they say, وَأَمَّا الْإِجْمَاعُ فَلَيْسَ بِنَاسِخٍ. Okay, the ijma' is not an abrogator, it can't abrogate. But it indicates an abrogation. بَلْ يَدُلُّ عَلَى ذَلِكَ. It indicates that there's an evidence there that abrogated it. Does that make sense? The evidence is what abrogated, and the consent gives us that reassurance that this text has abrogated. صح? Are we all together? So you can't say this got abrogated with a consent. A consent cannot abrogate. But it indicates that there's an evidence there that abrogated. Okay? What about if we're unable we can't even know the time. We're struggling in knowing which one came first, which one came after. We don't have it by nas. The Prophet never said it. So it's not like the first. We can't find out basically based on what? Sahabi never said that this one was the last of the two affairs or something like that. We couldn't know it by tariq, مثلاً. We struggled by knowing through the tariq. So what do we do? Half of the Ibn Hajar then says, وَإِن لَمْ يُعْرَفِ التَّارِيخُ فَلَا يَخْلُ إِمَّا أَن يُمْكِنَ تَرْجِعُ أَحَدِهِمَا عَلَى الْآخَرِ بِوَجْهِ مِنْ وُجُوهِ تَرْجِعِ. If we're unable to bring it, we don't know the tariqh now, which one came first and which one came after. We don't know. Half of the Ibn Hajar then says, it's one of two situations, or one of a couple of situations. First of all is, it is possible to do tarjih. Tarjih here means what? To say one is stronger than the other. Okay? Whichever wujuh of tarjih there is, whether it be connected to the metn, or whether it be connected to the isnad. Tarjih here means strengthening. What about if there's no ability, there's no one can do tarjih? No one can strengthen one over the other. They can't. فَإِنْ أَمْكَنَ التَّرْجِيحُ تَعَيَّنَ الْمَصِيرُ إِلَى إِبْنِ حَجَرٍ says, if you're able to do that, then you have to do tarjih. وَإِلَّا, and what about if you can't? Then it falls into التَّوَقُّف, the person withholds. You do tawakkuf of this issue, you stop talking about or implementing any of the two hadiths. You do tawakkuf, you withhold from it. And what do you say? Allahu A'lam. What do you say? Al-Imam al-Maraqi al-Su'ud, what did he say in his Alfiyah? What does he say? He says, فَكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَنَاحِ الْأَرْبَعِ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعَ فَكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَنَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَ The four a'immatu al-arba'a يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي. They say, we don't know when they don't know. وَكُلُّ مِنْ أَهْلِ الْمَنَاحِ الْأَرْبَعَ يَقُولُ لَا أَدْرِي. They say, I don't know. فَكُنْ مُتَّبِعَ Then be a follower in them in this regard as well. Don't just follow them in tahara, salah, and zakat, and hajj. Follow them in their wara. When they didn't know, they said, Allahu A'lam. وَلِذَلِكَ the scholars, they say, anybody who doesn't have with him, لَا أَدْرِي أُصِيبَتْ مَقَاتِلُهُ He's in danger. Because لَا أَدْرِي is the shield of the scholar. What is it? It's a skill and a student of knowledge. Is what we run to as a shield to run away from what? Ha. It's our way to shield ourselves. When somebody catches us, لا أدري. If you miss that, أصيبت مقاتله, your arrow will hit you. And it's not something to be embarrassed about to say لا أدري, because of the benefit that it has is that you go out of your way and you learn. صح? When you say لا أدري, I don't know, it makes you go out of your way and learn and study more and research this issue. But if every single thing you think you know it and you answer it, are you ever going to learn? You're not going to learn. You're not going to learn. There's a kitab written by Bakr Abu Zayd, rahimahullah ta'ala, Sheikh Bakr Abu Zayd, alayhi rahmatullah. There's a kitab called At-Ta'alum. What is it called? He calls At-Ta'alum. In the beginning of the book, he talks about a story of a man who every time he's asked a question, he answers it. Any question that is asked, anything it may be, he has an answer with him. He's got something to say, inshallah. And the signs of a ta'alum, that the person is self-taught, or he's a pseudo-scholar, as they say, yeah? So he mentions examples like that. So if we're unable to reconcile between the hadiths, and we're unable to bring it together, and it's tarjih, cannot be done. We can't strengthen one over the other. Then it becomes tahakkum. So you do tawakkuf. Tarjihun bighayri murajjahin yusamma tahakkum. If you can't do tarjih, you can't strengthen one opinion over another opinion because you don't have evidences for it. What do you do? You do tawakkuf, you withhold, you say Allahu A'lam, and you leave it. When you leave it, who deals with it later? Somebody else who can. Because it's impossible. Two ahadith, sahihaini, both of them are authentic. The Prophet said both of them, and there's no way to deal with it. And there's no way to deal with it, or there's no way to bring it together. No, the hadith can be brought together, and the hadith can be reconciled, and it can be dealt with. And there's ulama for it. So if you're not able to do it, there are other scholars who are what? Who are capable, who are able to do so. So the person does at-tawakuf. He does what? At-tawakuf. Pay attention here. What was the first point that we mentioned? The hadith is muhkam. Then it becomes what? Mukhtalaful. It becomes mukhtalaful hadith. Mukhtalaful hadith is when you're trying to do what? Jam' bayna nusus. You're trying to bring them together, right? And then does jam' take precedence over nasr? To bring the hadith together, sah? Does it take precedence over saying that one came before the other? So if there's a scholar out there that's saying this is abrogated, and another scholar is saying there is this possibility of this being مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ فَقَطْ. There's وَجْهُ الْجَمْعِ. Who takes precedence here? مُخْتَلَفُ الْحَدِيثِ. وَلِذَلَكَ that's what the fuqaha use against those who say the hadith of Jabir, of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said that the آخر الأمرين من رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم was what? تَرْكُ مِمَا مَسَتِ النَّارِ. This hadith, if you result to a nasq by even adding the camel meat in there, then that means that you're going to leave a wajhul jam' that can be done, which is to say that this hadith is am in its abrogation. And the hadith of what? Jabir is, the other hadith is what? Khas. So this is talking about everything other than the camel meat. Other than the camel meat. Hafiz ibn Hajar now, we finished maqbool. What have we finished? We finished the hadith from the angle of maqbool, the accepted hadith. Hafiz ibn Hajar, he's finished it for us now. Are we all together? We finished maqbool. What did we say? The maqbool was two times, right? The maqbool was what? It was two types. The first one is bi'tibari martabatihi, bi'tibari maratibihi, to be specific. In terms of its level, right? And he said, how much is that? Sahihan, hasan. Sahihun li dhati, hasanun li ghayri. Sahihun li dhati, sahihun li ghayri. Hasanun li dhati, hasanun li ghayri. We did that, we finished that. Then we went into the second type of maqbool. What did we say? Is bi'tibari al-amalu bih wa ghayru al-amali bih. That is what we took today. We took how much? Al-amalu bih is how much? What were the two? Al-Muhkam, Al-Mukhtalaf al-Hadith, sorry, Al-Nasikh. So it's Muhkam, Al-Nasikh. And we said, غير معمول به is what? Yeah? Mukhtalaf al-Hadith, Ali, Mansukh. We finished Maqbool. Maqbool is finished now. Now we're going to enter the Ahadith which are rejected. They are unacceptable. Which is what is called mardud. This is the second type of khabar, which is, this is the second type of, what did we say the ahad was? Two types, remember. بِعْتِبَارِهِ طُرُقِهِ. In terms of his turuq, how much did we say that was? Three. Mashhur, Aziz, and Gharib. And then we said بِعْتِبَارِ قُوَتِهِ وَضَعْفِهِ. There was maqbool and there's what? Mardud. We're now in mardud now. Mardud is the second type of خبر الأحد باعتبار قوته وضعفه. Are we all together? To be sharp here and focus. So we're in the مردود. Now pay attention. مردود is only two things that you just need to memorize. A hadith which is مردود. If you ever hear scholars say this hadith is ضعيف, this hadith is rejected, all they've said is that one of two things have happened. All you need to research is one of these two reasons that has happened to this hadith. Ibn Hajar is going to tell it to you. He says it to you here. Look, he says, ثُمَّ الْمَرْدُودُ إِمَّا أَن يَكُونَ لِسَقْطٍ أَوْ طَعْنٍ. Ah, those two. That's it. If you ever hear the scholars, they say, this hadith is ضعيف. It's rejected. It's one of two reasons why a hadith is turned down and it's rejected. The first reason is what? It is سَقْطٍ. سَقْط here means what? Disconnection. سَقْط means somebody has fallen out of the chain. Okay? Are we all together? The saqt is two types, ظاهر and خفي, that which is apparent and that which is hidden. It's hard to see that there's a disconnection here. Are we all together? The ظاهر, that which is apparent, is four types. The hadith, the disconnection which is apparent is four types. Number one that is مرسل, معلق, معضل, and منقطع. Those are the four. Those four are what? Those four are سقط, disconnection, that are ظاهر, apparent. Mm-hmm. Every individual who studies مصطلح, who studies books of hadith, will tend to be able to realize these type of disconnection. Whether it's مرسل, معضل, معضل, and منقطع, those four. Each one we're gonna. So I said معلق. Did I say معلق? مرسل, معلق, معضل, and منقطع. Those four. Those are ظاهر. They're easy to be seen by a طالب علم. A student of knowledge can see that. If he studies a bit of مصطلح, he can easily get to the bottom underline of why this disconnection happened. That's easy to identify. Like in the second type of disconnection, which is خفي, hidden type of, it's a hidden type of disconnection. This is two types. It's called what? مرسل الخفي. It's not like the normal مرسل that you knew. And the مدلس. The مدلس. The مدلس is خفي, and it's very hard for a طالب العلم or a person to see that. This is where the جهابدة النقاط. Bukhari will just come and this hadith is معلم. And you say, Shaykh Bukhari, Halima al-Bukhari, how is this hadith defected? For him, it's like gold. The owner of a gold shop, what would he do? Huh? When he sees you carrying gold and you're coming, he's like, Akhi, don't bring it in. There's no point in me looking at it. It's fake. I can see it from here. Ah, no. Umaris, he knows it, huh? AbdulRahman al-Mahdi said to him, he said, hadith is like that to us. AbdulRahman al-Mahdi, he said, AbdulRahman ibn al-Mahdi, he said, if you take to a goldsmith, huh? You take gold to him and you give it to him. Before he even weighs it, before he even looks into it, he knows that if it's real gold or if it's fake gold. Sah? He said, the scholars of hadith are like that when it comes to a hadith. They know it. Just by hearing it, their ears know it. Because they've become emerged into hadith. They know how it sounds. They know the way it is, the way it's said, the way the Prophet spoke. They've lived with him. What did the poet say? He said, أَهْلُ الْحَدِيثِ هُمْ أَصْحَابُ النَّبِيِّ وَإِنْ لَمْ يَصْحَبُ أَنْفَاسُهُمْ صَحِبُ. أَهْلُ الْحَدِيثِ are the people of the Prophet. Even if they did not befriend him, their souls befriended him, عليه الصلاة والسلام. Another poet said, دِينُ النَّبِيِّ مُحَمَّدٍ أَخْبَارُ نِعْمَ الْمَطِيَّةُ لِلْفَتَى الْآثَارُ لَا تَعْدِلَنَّ عَنِ الْحَدِيثِ وَأَهْلِهِ فالرأي ليل والحديث نهار ولربما غلط الفتى أثر الهدى والشمس بازغة لها أنوار. These people are people who've enjoyed hadith, lived by it, treasured it. And there's a kitab written by Imam Khatib al-Baghdadi, it's called شرف أصحاب الحديث. Khatib al-Baghdadi wrote a book where he talks about the honor and the virtue of the people of hadith. Okay. That's two types of what? Disconnection that happens to the what? The chain. Then we come to the second type of why a hadith is rejected. What is it? Al-ta'anu. Ibn Hajar mentions it for you here. What does he say? Aw ta'nin. Ta'nin means what? It's a criticism on who? The narrator. The criticism that is put to a narrator is one of two. It's one of two. Either he's been criticized for his adala. Adala could be his integrity, sah? His morality, his integrity. That's what adala is. And inshallah ta'ala, the adala we're going to see is five. Five. Al-kadibu, mutahamu bil-kadibi, al-fisqu, al-bid'a, and al-jahala. Those five, inshallah, we're going to see them, don't worry. Are five. Al-kadibu, tuhmatul kadibi, al-fisq, al-bid'a, and al-jahala. Those five are criticism on his integrity. And then we come to what? we come to the second type of criticism that can be put to a narrator, which is what? Is his dhabt, his precision and his memory. Okay? He can be criticized for what? Yeah? He can be criticized for his precision, his dhabt, how he's precise in terms of the hadith. And those are five as well. Ibn Hajj is going to bring them. The first one is fuhshul ghalat, that he does excessive mistakes and he does. The second one is su'ul hifd, his memory is excessive. Al ghafla, kathratul awham, al mukhalafatul thiqat. These are the five that we're going to see. So it's fuhshul ghalat. Don't worry, inshallah, it's all going to come. Fuhshul ghalat, su'ul fahmi, al ghafla, kathratul awham, al mukhalafatul thiqat. Those five are the, again, the precision, the narrator, rahimahullah. And inshallah ta'ala, after that, Hafiz al-Hajr is going to be speaking about all of the types of mukhalafat al-thiqat that come. The maqloob, the mudraj, the al-mazidu fi al-muttasil al-asanid. And he talks about al-musahhaf, and then he talks about the muharraf, or the muttarib as it's called. All of these are types of what? Mukhalafat al-thiqat, how a person would oppose the narrators. We'll speak about all of that. And then at the ending of the book, Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, he talks about matters that have nothing to do with mawdu'ul of mustalah per se. Okay? He talks about the issue of ijaza and the issue of al-wijada and the issue of how to take siyaghul ada' and etc. Which we will touch on inshallah ta'ala. So, now you have an idea of what mardood is. He says, ثُمَّ الْمَرْدُودُ إِمَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ لِسَقْطٍ أَوْ طَعْنٍ. The mardood, إِمَّا it is أَنْ يَكُونَ لِسَقْطٍ, it's either because it's what? سَقْط. سَقْط, which we just said, is disconnection. أَوْ طَعْنٍ, or there's a criticism towards the narrator. The narrator's been criticized. He's been criticized. Now Ibn Hajar mentions to you that types of criticism, the types of disconnection there are, the five. He says, وَالسَّقْتُ إِمَّا أَن يَكُونَ. The disconnection is one of five. The first one is مِن مَبْدَأِ السَّنَدِ. It's from the مَبْدَأُ السَّنَدِ مِن مُصَنَّفٍ. It's from who? From the author of the book. The author of the book, from him. That's called مُعَلَّق. Bukhari misses his teacher. It's called مُعَلَّق. So Bukhari says, حدثنا الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير. صحيح. حدثنا الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير. Are we all together? So حميدي here is who? Shaykh al-Bukhari. If Bukhari misses حميدي عبد الله بن زبير, and he says مثلا حدثنا الحميدي عبد الله بن, first hadith of Bukhari is وإنما الأعمال بالنيات. What's the sentence for it? حدثنا الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير, and then after is what? قال حدثنا يحيى بن إبراهيم, يحيى بن إبراهيم, يحيى بن إسماعيل الأنصاري. Yeah, يحيى الأنصاري رحمه الله. And then is what? محمد إبراهيم التيمي, and علقمة بن أبي وقاص الليثي, and عمر بن الخطاب. صح. Five. Bukhari narrated this from who? الحميدي عبد الله بن زبير. If Bukhari misses حميدي عبد الله بن زبير, and he jumps to Ibrahim ibn Yahya al-Ansari rahimahullah, what does it then become? It becomes a mu'allaq. Bukhari's teacher is missing. He missed his teacher. This hadith is called what? It's called mu'allaq. Bukhari didn't mention his teacher. ولذلك الإمام البخاري, the hadith that he doesn't mention his teacher, are we all together? That the Bukhari doesn't mention his teacher, he just says قال رسول الله. Sometimes you find Sahih Bukhari when you're reading it, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Or sometimes Bukhari would say قال أبو هريرة. Bukhari and Abu Huraira, بينهما مفاوز. Between Bukhari and Abu Huraira, there is the big distance. So what did Bukhari do here? Did he mu'allaqan? He cut off his teacher. Who's he? Who did he hear from your teacher? To Abu Huraira. But scholars, they say مُعَلَّقَاتُ الْبُخَارِيُّ, the hadith which are mu'allaq in Bukhari are what? مَحْمُولٌ عَلَى اتِّصَالٍ. They are considered to be connected with the condition that are what? That's not mu'allaqat, sorry. The hadith which are an'anat al-Bukhari. Sorry, that's an'anat al-Bukhari. Now, hadith which are mu'allaq that Bukhari narrates, the scholars, they categorize it into two. The way that Bukhari transmits it. If Bukhari, مثلا, says, qala. Mathalan, he says. Sah? Abu Huraira said. Are we together? The scholars, they say that if he narrates it, and he narrates it bisighatil jazm, qala is jazm, it's conviction. He does it with conviction. Qala, he said. Okay? Rawa, he narrated. Sahih? All of these are sahihun inda al-Bukhari. But they are not, laysa min shurutihi, they are not from his conditions of his sahih. Does that make sense? But if he narrates it with the word ruwiya, qila, like the hukiya, mathalan, which are all what? Sighatu tamrid. Sighatu tamrid. According to Bukhari, this hadith is weak. That's how they distinguish between it. It could be sahih sometimes, even though he made it weak, it could be sahih to other people. But to him, it's not seen as sahih. Are we all together? That's what Bukhari rahimahullah does. And then mu'allaq is what? Mu'allaq is basically when the min mabda'i sanadi min musannafin. Musannaf is an author, like Bukhari. He, the beginning of the chain, is his teacher, is missing from the chain. Sahih. As a side point, here I have to mention a point, which is, you know the famous hadith that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, the hadith of Abi Malik al-Ash'ari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Bukhari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, سَيَكُونَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ مِّنْ أُمَّتِي يَسْتَحِلُّونَ الْحِرَّ وَالْحَرِيرَ وَالْمَعَازِفِ. The famous hadith of Bukhari, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibiting the music. Some people weakened it. Like who? Ibn Hazm rahimahullah, مثلاً. ولذلك عراقي says in his Alfiya, عن عانة كخبر المعازف لا تصل ابن حزم المخالف. Like the narration of who? Bukhari's عن عانة. Bukhari here, the reason why they said that this hadith is not authentic is because Bukhari said, قال هشام ابن عمار. Okay? He didn't say حدثنا. He didn't say Muhammad, sorry, Hisham ibn Ammar told us. He said qala. So he said, because he said qala, this hadith is disconnected. Why hasn't he mentioned if he heard it from him directly? Why didn't he say, I heard it from him? Many scholars responded to him. Ibn Qayyim responded to him, rahimahullah. Shawkani is of the opinion of Ibn Hazm. But Sheikh Albani and others, Sheikh Albani wrote the kitab, Tahrimu Alati al-Darb. And Sheikh Nasir, mashallah, fassala fil mas'ala. But here it is that Ibn Hajar, Imam al-Bukhari, Muhammad Ismail al-Bukhari, first of all, Hisham al-Ammar, min shuyukhi, he's from his teachers. Sahih? Two, Imam al-Bukhari, he's an'ana, the way he, if he doesn't narrate it with tasrih al-sama', he doesn't say hadathana, akhbarana, anba'ana, he doesn't say that. Bukhari's qala, and his an, is mahmulun ala tisal. The scholars say it's taken as what? Connection. Does that make sense? And also Bukhari narrated it what? بِسِيغَةِ الْجَزْمِ, right? Did he not say قَالَ هِشَامٌ عَمَرٌ? Did he say قِيلَ? Huh? He said what? Plus, just so that you makes it even more better, Ibn Abu Bakr ibn al-Imam Ibn Abi Shayba, sorry, Ibn Abi Shayba, in his Musannaf, he brought this hadith connected, if that makes it better for you guys. If it makes it better, he brought it muttasilan, connected. So to say that the hadith is weak is either a person. لذلك الإمام ابن حزم رحمه مع جلالته وقدره. However, how honorable he is and respected he is in his knowledge and his understanding. مع ذلك, when it comes to issue of a hadith, he is what? The scholars, they clearly say he's حاطب الليل. In this field, he's not given many weight, especially when he goes against the jamaheer of the ulama. صحيح. Ibn Hazm rahimahullah lam yara, he never saw Surah Tirmidhi aslan. He never saw it. Wa hakam ala Tirmidhi, and he placed on Tirmidhi jahala. He said Tirmidhi is majhul. Hazm said that Tirmidhi is what? He said he's majhul, he's unknown. Who is he? And the scholars, they said, this is not a criticism to Tirmidhi, by the way. It goes back to you, Ibn Hazm. It makes you look bad, not Tirmidhi bad. Tirmidhi ma'roof, everyone knows him. Huh? So if you haven't seen Sunnah Tirmidhi, then that takes away a lot of your knowledge of hadith, right? It does. We'll stop there, inshallah ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.